like communion.
Thank you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm Pastor Gary Deshay, and I want to welcome you to our Sunday worship with communion today and our live stream via Facebook here at Christ Lutheran Church. On piano, we have Brother Mark Wieda,
and
Sue Deshay,
and
the accordion as well. Mark is going to play the accordion absolutely beautifully. It's an amazing instrument. It's touched my heart this morning. I'm kind of emotional this morning from all of the good music that we're going to provide for you to help you and lead you into worship this morning. Before we get to our announcements, in your bulletin, there is the first summary of our scripture readings. And it says, when King David lived in his house and the Lord had given him rest from all his surrounding enemies, he piously supposed that he would build a house for God. But the Lord would turn it around. He would establish a house for David and an everlasting throne. This he has done not only for David, but also for all his people in the son of David, Jesus Christ, conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. That holy child, the incarnate Son of the Most High, receives the throne of his father David and begins to reign over the house of Jacob forever. Having given himself as a sacrifice for the sins of the world, his body is the true and eternal temple of God, in which his people have their own place of peace and rest. That is the mystery that was kept secret for long ages, but is now made known to all nations according to the command of the eternal God, in order that we may have faith and life in Christ. Amen. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. Let us seek after that reality in our nation's life. We're still accepting mittens and hats for the CLC mitten tree. We're collecting until the end of this month. And we've already filled up the tree twice and sent the mittens and the hats over to the children at Piedmont Elementary. So let's fill it up a third time, okay? All right. Confirmation will be this Wednesday from 4 to 5, and youth Bible study from 5:15 to 6 p.m. at the Parsonage with Sue. And our Advent services and live stream, put this on your schedule, folks. Wednesday the 23rd at 6:30 p.m. What a beautiful picture. That's beautiful. And especially our Christmas Eve candlelight service beginning at 5, and then we'll have another candlelight service at 11 p.m. Mark your calendar for those too. I have one other announcement here. We had our Christ Lutheran Church Community Food Share Friday. We gave away 55 bags. 55 bags. Isn't that amazing? Do you know we have over 90 people on our list? 90 people that have signed up. Praise the Lord, right? Amen. Praise the Lord. What is really interesting about this is we've been getting letters. Well, we've got three letters from teachers at Piedmont. And the last one we got from a teacher said that their community is so blessed that we care for them. Amen?
Amen.
That's what we're here to do. We're here to care for our community, and the community needs to know that we're doing that, and we're doing that. That's what we're about. Right? That's what we're about. And, even after the food share was over, I must have given away, enough Super One cards for like four families after that, So you can say almost 60 people were blessed this week. One lady told me, now we can have Christmas dinner. Me and my family can have Christmas dinner. Thank you, she said. You know, that's what it's all about. That's what warms our heart during this time period. And throughout the rest of the year, it should as well, that we're ministering to the least of these, our brethren, you know, in any way that we can. Okay? And the CLC food share is just one step for us to get out into our community, and that we shine as a beacon here high on the hill for Duluth. Okay. Yes, sir? Huh? Oh, yes, I am going to do that. Thank you. Thank you. And now we are going to light the last Advent candle. And that candle is the angel candle, or the candle of love, the fourth Advent candle. And the angels announce the good news of a Savior, saying, I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. God sent his only Son to earth to save us because he loves us. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. And there's the last candle. Thank you, Gabe. Yeah. Let's prepare our hearts and minds to confess our sins unto God and receive the absolution. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. We confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. By what we have done, and by what we have left undone, we have not loved you with our whole heart, and we have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. And now Almighty God in his mercy has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all of your sins. And as a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all of your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. We have some beautiful music lined up today. So our first song for us to let our light shine, and let us praise and rejoice in the Lord this morning. Rise up, shepherd, and follow. Please rise up and sing with us as you're able. Rise up, shepherd, and follow.
Thank you.
be seated. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we're at a time of the year, and especially of the church year, where we are anticipating. We're anticipating the celebration of the birth of Jesus Christ, but we're also anticipating that Christmas morning when the children get up and race into the bedroom and, "Mommy, Daddy, Santa Claus is here. He came. Look at all the presents under the tree." And so we get up staggering down the stairs or down the hallway to where the big Christmas tree is all lit up and the presents are all under the tree. And at the same time, we see Mary and Joseph around the baby, the star shining right over them, the shepherds coming up, falling to their knees and worshiping the newborn babe, Jesus. And now we anticipate his return to deliver us from a world of darkness, of a world of sin and injustice and evil. That little babe would take so much upon himself. He would become our Savior, our healer, our sanctifier, and now our soon coming King. God, we wait patiently for your birth again and your coming. Help us to eternalize these truths, God, for us by the power of your Holy Spirit. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Now we'll hear from God's word this morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Can you hear me? Okay. Oh, it's good to see your faces. Welcome, welcome. And welcome to those of you who are with us on the Facebook. Amen. You'll notice in your bulletin, the reading for the first, for the Old Testament reading is not correct, but on the screens, it is correct. And the correct reading is 2 Samuel 7, 1 through 16. Now when the king lived in his house, and the Lord had given him rest from all his surrounding enemies, the king said to Nathan the prophet, "See now, I dwell in a house of cedar, but the ark of God dwells in a tent." And Nathan said to the king, "Go and do all that is in your heart, for the Lord is with you." But that same night, the word of the Lord came to Nathan, "Go and tell my servant David, thus says the Lord, would you build me a house to dwell in? I have not lived in a house since the day I brought up the people of Israel from Egypt to this day, but I have been moving about in a tent for my dwelling. In all places where I've moved with all the people of Israel, did I speak a word with any of the judges of Israel, whom I commanded to shepherd my people Israel, saying, why have you not built me a house of cedar? Now therefore, thus you shall say to my servant David, thus says the Lord of hosts, I took you from the pasture, from following the sheep, that you should be prince over my people Israel. And I have been with you wherever you went, and I have cut off all your enemies from before you. And I will make for you a great name, like the name of the great ones of the earth. And I will appoint a place for my people Israel, and will plant them, so that they may dwell in their own place and be disturbed no more. And violent men shall afflict them no more as formerly, from the time that I appointed judges over my people Israel, and I will give you rest from all your enemies. Moreover, the Lord declares to you that the Lord will make you a house. When your days are fulfilled and you lie down with your fathers, I will raise up your offspring after you, who shall come from your body, and I will establish his kingdom. He shall build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. I will be to him a father, and he shall be to me a son. When he commits iniquity, I will discipline him with the rod of men, with the stripes of the sons of men, but my steadfast love will not depart from him, as I took it from Saul, whom I put away from before you. And your house and your kingdom shall be made sure forever before me. Your throne shall be established forever. Now the gradual is Psalm 89, verses 1 through 5, and then 19 to 20. 29, sorry. A maskil of Ethan the Ezrahite. I will sing of the steadfast love of the Lord forever. With my mouth, I will make known your faithfulness to all generations. For I said, steadfast love will be built up forever. In the heavens, you will establish your faithfulness. You have said, I have made a covenant with my chosen one. I have sworn to David, my servant, I will establish your offspring forever and build your throne for all generations. Selah. Let the heavens praise your wonders, O Lord, your faithfulness in the assembly of the holy ones. Of old, you spoke in a vision to your godly one, and you said, I have granted help to one who is mighty. I have exalted one chosen from the people. I have found David, my servant. With my holy oil I have anointed him, so that my hand shall be established with him. My arm also shall strengthen him. The enemy shall not outwit him. The wicked shall not humble him. I will crush his foes before him and strike down those who hate him. My faithfulness and my steadfast love shall be with him, and in my name shall his horn be exalted. I will set his hand on the sea and his right hand on the rivers. He shall cry to me, you are my Father, my God, and the rock of my salvation. And I will make him the firstborn, the highest of the kings of the earth. My steadfast love I will keep for him forever, and my covenant will stand firm for him. I will establish his offspring forever and his throne as the days of the heavens. This is so epic. Praise the Lord. Now our New Testament reading is from the letter to the Romans, chapter 16, 25 through 27. It's very short, but it seals up and reaches back to what we just read. Now to him who is able to strengthen you according to my gospel and the preaching of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery that was kept secret for long ages, but now has been disclosed, and through the prophetic writings has been made known to all nations, according to the command of the eternal God, to bring about the obedience of faith. To the only wise God be glory forever through Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Please stand as you're able. Let's ask God to open our eyes to hear the gospel this morning. Gospel lesson today is taken from Luke chapter 1, verse 26 through 38. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and said, "Greetings, O favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was greatly troubled at the saying, and tried to discern what sort of greeting this might be. And the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. And he will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David. And he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end. And Mary said to the angel, "How will this be, since I am a virgin?" And the angel answered her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God. And behold, your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month with her who was called barren. For nothing will be impossible with God." And Mary said, "Behold, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word." And the angel departed from her. This is the gospel of our Lord. Thanks be to you, Lord Christ. Please be seated. Behold, a virgin shall conceive. Luke 1, 26 and 27 says, "In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man named Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary." Who is this virgin? Well, Mary was a young, poor female, all characteristics to the people of her day that would make her seem unusable by God. However, God chose Mary for one of the most important acts of obedience that he'd ever demanded of anyone. Gabriel appeared not only to Zechariah and to Mary, but also the prophet Daniel more than 500 years earlier. And each time Gabriel appeared, he brought important messages from God. You may feel that your ability or your experience, beloved, or even your education makes you an unlikely candidate for God's service. Beloved, don't limit God's choices. He can use you, and he asked you to trust him. Mary was highly favored. Now, Mary's cousin, Elizabeth, exclaimed when they met, "Blessed are you among women, and your child will be blessed." There's an interesting word here that is different from the word the angel used in our reading this morning. Eulogeo, or eulogeo, is the root for eulogemeni, which means to speak well of, that is, to bless, to thank, or to invoke a benediction upon. And for Christians, by this we understand that Mary had a unique privilege to be the mother of the Son of God. What Mary didn't know was God's blessing on Mary, the honor of her being the mother of the Messiah, would lead to much pain. Her peers would ridicule her. Her fiancé would come close to leaving her. Her son would be rejected and murdered. Through her son would come the world's only hope. And this is why Mary has been praised by countless generations. Her submission was part of God's plan to bring about our salvation. If sorrow, beloved, if sorrow weighs you down and dims your hope, think of Mary and wait patiently for God to finish working out his plan in your life. The baby's name is Jesus. Jesus is the Greek form of the Hebrew name Joshua or Yeshua. And it was a common name meaning the Lord saves. Just as Joshua had led Israel into the promised land, so Jesus would lead his people into eternal life. In Jesus' name, people were healed, demons cast out, and sins were forgiven. God had promised David that his kingdom would last forever. This promise was fulfilled in the coming of Jesus, a direct descendant of David, whose kingdom will never end. When God became incarnate, he began a comprehensive and astounding work of reconciliation that healed and saved every last aspect of our fallen nature from cradle to the grave. The miracle that creates faith. The birth of Jesus to a virgin is a miracle that many people find hard to believe. That's one of the things that a lot of people can't wrap their heads around, that aren't Christians, that aren't believers. They just think that's a myth, it's a fantasy. The birth of Jesus was not just like any other birth. Mary gave birth to God. She is the Theotokos, the birth giver of God. C.S. Lewis remarked, "The central miracle asserted by Christians is the incarnation. Every other miracle prepares for this, or exhibits this, or results from this miracle. The fitness and therefore credibility of the particular miracles depend on their relation to the grand miracle, the incarnation. All discussion of them in isolation from the miracle birth of Jesus is futile." Because if it wasn't for him being born, there would be no miracles to speak of. You know, even Martin Luther declared, "He, Jesus Christ, condescends to assume my flesh and body, my soul." Well, I'm sorry. "He comes to assume my flesh and blood, my body and soul. He does not become an angel or another magnificent creature. He becomes man. He is a token of God's mercy to wretched human beings like you and me. The human heart cannot grasp or understand it, let alone express it. The miracle of the nativity of Jesus is the supreme mystery, as Paul spoke of. It's the supreme mystery of the gospel. Author John Clark says, "The mystery is not found in the Good Friday event of Christ's crucifixion, or even in the Easter Sunday event of his resurrection. Rather, the Christmas event of Christ's birth is where the profoundest and most unfathomable depths of the Christian revelation lie. Nothing in fiction is so fantastic as is this truth of the incarnation." As some people say, you just can't make that stuff up. Beloved, this Advent or Christmas season is as good a time as ever to renew our sense and awe and astonishment at the miracle of the incarnation. To return our confession of the Word become flesh to the very center of our church life, our worship, and our witness. Risk disaster. A young unmarried girl who became pregnant, risk disaster in her day, in Mary's day. Unless the father of the child agreed to marry her, she would probably remain unmarried for her life. If her own father rejected her, she would be forced into begging or prostitution in order to earn a living. Mary, with her story about becoming pregnant by the Holy Spirit, risked being considered crazy as well. Still, Mary said, "Despite the possible risks, may it be done to me according to your word." When Mary said that, she didn't even know about the tremendous opportunity she would have. She only knew that God was asking her to serve him, and she willingly obeyed. Beloved, don't wait to see the bottom line before offering yourself to God. Offer yourself willingly, even when the outcome may seem disastrous. The Bible gives us two examples of this. First, from 1 Peter 3:15, where he says, "But sanctify, set apart or make holy, but sanctify Christ as Lord in your hearts, always being ready to make defense to everyone who asks you to give an account of the hope that's in you, yet with gentleness and reverence." Secondly, James 4:7 tells us, "So place yourself under God's authority. Take a stand against the devil, and he will flee from you." God's announcement of the birth of a special child was met with various responses throughout Scripture. Sarah, Abraham's wife, she laughed. Zechariah doubted. By contrast, with resignation to the will of God, Mary submitted. She believed the angel's words, and by faith in the promise of God, she opened herself to bear the child, even under humanly impossible circumstances. Beloved, God is able to do the impossible. Our response to God's demands should not be laughter or doubt, but willing acceptance. Remember, we are enabled to be willing. Do you know that? We are enabled to be willing. For back again, and I always say this to people, Philippians 2, 12 and 13 says, "Therefore, my beloved, just as you have always obeyed me, not only in my presence, but much more now in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who is at work in you, enabling you both to will and to work for his good pleasure." He gives you the want to and the power to do his good pleasure. Beloved, what better time than this Advent season to retrieve and rejoice in the comprehensive and monumental significance of the eternal Word become flesh? The eternal Word became flesh, and he left no aspect of our sin-ravaged nature untouched and unreconciled. No, he didn't. This is put into the melodious voice of the church, that song which these few phrases say, "He comes to make his blessings flow far as the curse is found." Far as the curse is found. Dr. Peter Jones, he wrote, "The birth of this unique man-child in the little town of Bethlehem long ago brings sanity to humanity, and especially to our time of revolutionary change." Think about that. The man Jesus is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation, and in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell. Jesus is the final revelation of God in human form for two reasons: so that fallen human beings can understand in a definitive way who the great God of the universe is, as a God of love and condescension. He comes to you. He comes to us. And number two, so that we could know who we were meant to be. God's people were predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son. Beloved, in this life, those who are in Christ Jesus become more and more like him. And in the future, just as we have borne the image of the man of dust, the original Adam, we shall also bear the image of the man of heaven, the second Adam, who came from heaven to save us and who will resurrect us. The human male baby, born of a woman created in God's image, is what the Creator gave us at Christmas time. Jesus is the perfect image of who we were meant to be. Thus, we need the incarnation. We need the final revelation of God in human form, who, bearing our sins, died on the cross for us and was raised from the dead in newness of life. Beloved, are you ready and willing to place yourself under God's authority? Are you seeking God to reveal His will to you? Are you ready to place your faith and trust in God, not knowing what the future will bring? Jesus, the Messiah, has come to us, for us, and He is here for you today. But as many as received Him, to them He gave the right to become children of God, even to those who believe in His name, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. May God be praised forever. Amen. The hymn of the day, or the sermon hymn today, is "I Wonder as I Wander." It's a beautiful, beautiful song. Please stand as you're able, and let us confess our faith through the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of His Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. The third day He rose again according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. He will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins. And I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please be seated. Receive our offering. I'm sorry, please stand as we receive our offering and we sing, "Oh Bless These Gifts."
Oh bless these gifts, and bless the
Father, for the gifts that we bring back to you, which we received from your bountiful grace. Receive these now, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated.
It's time for All Is Well.
Please follow along in your bulletin for our service of Holy Communion. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord.
It's right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who, having created all things, took on human flesh and was born of the Virgin Mary. And for our sake he died on the cross and rose from the dead to put an end to death. thus fulfilling your will and gaining for you a holy people. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna, 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 Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed are you, Lord of heaven and earth, for you have had mercy on those whom you created and sent your only begotten Son into our flesh to bear our sin and be our Savior. With repentant joy we receive the salvation accomplished for us by the all-availing sacrifice of his body and blood on the cross. Gathered in the name and the remembrance of Jesus, we beg you, O Lord, to forgive, renew, and strengthen us with your word and spirit. Grant us faithfully to eat his body and drink his blood as he bids us do in his own testament. Gather us together, we pray, from the ends of the earth to celebrate with all the faithful the marriage feast of the Lamb in his kingdom, which has no end. Graciously receive our prayers. Deliver and preserve us, and to you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship, with the Son, with the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord Jesus Christ, on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and gave it to his disciples, and said, Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. In the same way, he also took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. As often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Amen. Come Lord Jesus. O Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, in giving us your body and blood to eat and drink, you lead us to remember and confess your holy cross and passion, your blessed death and your rest in the tomb, your resurrection from the dead, your ascension into heaven, your coming for the final judgment. So remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you. Together. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, grant us peace. Now, beloved, take and eat. This is the true body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, given into death for your sins. Amen. Take and drink. This is the true blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, shed for the forgiveness of your sins. Amen. Thank you. May the body and blood of our Lord and Savior preserve and keep you from this day forth and forevermore, body and soul. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift. And we implore you that of your mercy, you would strengthen us through the same in faith toward you and fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Receive the benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. That peace which passes all of your understanding. And you're going out and you're coming in and you're lying down and you're rising up. From this day forth and forevermore. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We want you to sing along with us now, okay?
And as you're able, when we do this last song.
Thank you.
another time of worship has come and gone. I pray that God has blessed you. I pray that God's word has sunk deep into your heart. Go now and love your neighbor as yourself. Try to know Christ more and make him known to others. And when you leave here, think about this, that you're going out to the mission field. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Go in peace and serve the Lord. God bless you all, and thank you for joining us on Facebook Live. Today, our email address is listed there on the screen, and our web address is clcduluth.org. And come visit us. Remember, our next midweek Advent service and our Christmas Eve service is at 5 and 11 p.m. Christmas Eve. God bless you all.
Amen.